Well, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm very surprised to see so many people at this conference. I mean, I'm impressed how much it has grown over the years. So, yeah, well. I'm going to talk about the mechanism, and as you can see, it's done in collaboration with Martin Enghoff, who is in my institute, and also Nir, and actually my son has also been involved since 2009, actually, in working with us. So what you see in this picture is more or less what I'm going to talk about today, which is an effect from space on the Earth's climate. And the general idea is that cosmic rays from space that is out here, we have energetic particles which are accelerated and they enter into the atmosphere. And we have spent more or less a large number of years trying to understand why there should be a connection between these particles entering into the atmosphere and then the Earth's cloud cover. And that's a story I want to tell you. 10 years ago, I would be very uncertain if we had the right idea, but now I think we are getting much more certain that we are on the right path. So I'm going to talk about cosmic rays and clouds and about the physical mechanism between ionization and cloud formation, and then some further empirical evidence in order to show you that there might be such a connection between cosmic rays and clouds. So where do cosmic rays come from? They come from large stars that explode. So these are the cosmic rays we are interested in. Oh, sorry. Do I go back here? Yeah. So when these stars explode, they accelerate particles to enormous energy, and then they enter into the solar system. And when they enter into the solar system, they meet the sun's activity, that is the magnetic activity. So what you see down here is from 1960 to about 2000, and the orange curve here is just the sunspots that you probably have seen so many times. But up here, you see the changes in cosmic rays, and you see when you have many sunspots, you have a low cosmic ray flux. That's because the shielding is better when the sun is very active. So you have this inverse correlation between the two. Now, when these particles enter into the atmosphere, they actually produce ions. So you see these ions here. And on top of that, because the energies are so high, you produce new isotopes. And one of the isotopes is, for instance, carbon-14. And carbon-14 then goes together with the oxygen molecule and becomes CO2, but it's a slightly heavier form of CO2. It goes into a tree and then it might end up in a tree rings, as you see here. And if you measure the carbon-12 relative to the carbon-14, you can, from a certain ring, say something about how active the sun was back in time. So the interesting thing is that each time there is a change in cosmic rays, it looks as if there is a change in climate. And this is what we are seeing here. Up here, this is the last 1,000 years, more or less, where you see a temperature curve where you have the medieval warm period, you have the Little Ice Age, and then you have the modern instrument record. But down here, you have the changes. It says in carbon-14, but you can say it's solar activity and cosmic rays. So down here, you have more cosmic rays coming in because the solar activity is low. And when you have a high cosmic ray flux, it appears that you have a colder climate and vice versa. So you see this beautiful correlation. And it's not just in Europe that we have seen that it has a large effect on civilization. This is a work, sorry, this is a work it published in Science, and it has to do with the Asian monsoon. where you see here the medieval warm period and the Little Ice Age. And the interesting thing is that each time there is a large change in the monsoon, the dynasty, that is sort of the end, and a new dynasty appears. So it says something about that there is a relationship between culture and these changes in climate, just to say that it has had significant influence on civilization, these changes. So here I'm trying to quantify, as Nia also did, the effect of solar activity. So here you see the changes in solar activity with the 11-year cycle, and then you see that this ocean expanding. You can see how much heat is going in, and from that you can calculate the forcing from solar activity, and you get a figure that looks something like this, where depending on which data set you are using, you're getting between 1 and 1.5 watt forcing over a solar cycle. So here you see the total solar irradiance. It's almost a factor of 10 too low. So if we are going to explain this, we need an amplification mechanism. So what can the amplification mechanism be? So the idea that we had has to do with clouds, as you can see here in this beautiful animation from a geostationary satellite. So the net effect of clouds is that they cool the atmosphere with between 20 and 30 watts per square meter. So if you have a systematic change in the Earth's cloudiness, you will be able to change the climate on the Earth. So that was sort of the initial idea we had already in 1995. So it goes a long way back, where we produced this type of figure. So this is from 1983 until 2006. And what you see here in the red curve is actually the change in cosmic rays. And you see this solar cycle modulation. And the blue curve, that is changes in low clouds. And it's measured by a whole fleet of satellites. And unfortunately, already here in 94, there was some calibration problem, and we tried to fix it, and we couldn't fix them because now the calibration is completely off. So we cannot sort of give further support to this correlation, but that was the sort of the initial evidence that gave us the idea that maybe cosmic rays are linked to clouds. And the interesting thing here is also that the change that you see in clouds is about 1 to 2%. And if you look at this next figure, you can see that the forcing from 1 to 2% is in the right order of magnitude to explain these observations over the 11-year solar cycle. So if clouds are important, and if cosmic rays are connected to clouds, then the question is what is the mechanism behind this? And in order to understand a little about clouds, we have to look at how you actually form a cloud droplet. And you can see it here. So in order to get a cloud droplet, you have to have a surface on which water vapor can condense. And that is what you call a cloud condensation nuclei. It's typically about 50 nanometer. And what is interesting in this context is that most of these cloud condensation nuclei that we are interested in are over the oceans. And here, these cloud condensation nuclei, they actually start as gas molecules that then condense into a small molecular cluster. And then by taking up more of this gas, and maybe also by collisions, they grow, and that takes about a week, and then they can become cloud condensation nuclei. So the idea that we had was that this ionization here, when you have these charges, they help the stabilization of these small clusters. And by stabilizing them, that means that they don't evaporate so easily, and therefore they might survive and grow to cloud condensation nuclei. So I can show you here in this figure that if you change the cloud condensation nuclei, you are changing the cloud properties. What you see here is a region from a satellite where you have over the oceans, and you see these stripes, and this is where ships have been sailing. And as the ship sails, it sends out a lot of small aerosols that can function as cloud condensation nuclei. So in these stripes, you change the number of cloud condensation nuclei, and you can see it changes the optical properties quite dramatically of the clouds. So that is the general idea. So with these ideas, we could then try and begin to test whether we experimentally could see any of these effects. So we have, over the last 10 years, been involved in a large number of experiments. This is an ongoing experiment at the Technical University in Lyngby in Denmark. We were also involved in the cloud experiment at CERN, and we have also used the accelerator in Aarhus University. At some point, we were even 1.1 kilometer underground in order to avoid cosmic rays. But let me show you one of the first results that we got, which has also been confirmed in the cloud project. So the idea is to look at the formation of small aerosols, so we can, within our chamber, we can add ionization by gamma rays. So by increasing the ionization, this is what we are doing down here, and that is sort of a proxy for cosmic rays. And up here we measure small aerosols, which are they're all on the order of 3 nanometers. And you can see that as we increase the ionization, we actually increase the number of small aerosols. And when we did that initially, we thought that, okay, we can simply produce more small aerosols, so now they just have to grow to become cloud condensation nuclei, and that would be the mechanism. But it turns out that that is simply too simple. And the problem is that these small 3 nanometer particles, they have to grow almost a million in their mass in order to become cloud condensation nuclei. And there's a big chance that they get lost. They get lost on larger particles. And one of the things that happened was that a number of groups, after we got our results with the experiments, they try to test it in big models. So they used big numerical models to see if they now put extra in of these small aerosols, will they then grow to cloud condensation nuclei? And that's something you can test in a global model. And here is one model, and this is from 2011. Down here you see the size of the particles. So here you have 1 nanometer, 10 nanometer, and 100 nanometer. And then you put in about 5% extra small aerosols, and then you look at the fate of these small aerosols in the model, and you see as they grow, fewer and fewer survives to cloud condensation nuclei. And if you want to explain the observations we are seeing, we would expect that if you had a few percent here, you would also get a few percent more cloud condensation nuclei. So the models are more or less saying no, that this effect is too small to affect clouds. So one could say that we have experimental, at that time we had experimental evidence that this is going on, we are producing these small aerosols, but these models all said that this is not working in our models. And that has been used to say that this theory and is still being used to say that this theory is probably dead. However, we spent a number of years doing experiments. This is the experiment in Copenhagen. And what we did was try to test the growth of aerosols experimentally to see if there is an effect. And let me see. Yeah, this is experiment. So what we did, and this is one of the experimental plots. What you see down here is the time going in hours. So it's about 15 days. And up here, you have the size of particles. So what we are doing is that we, every fourth hour, we increase the ionization in the chamber. And then after 4 hours, we turn it off. And then we wait 4 hours. So we repeat this in a periodic way. And the whole idea is to see if ionization is helping the growth of particles, of aerosol particles. And the reason that we are doing so many experiments here, it is because we are trying to measure changes in the growth rate that is less than 1%. That's because the experimental conditions are such that we can only measure changes in the growth rate on the order of 1%. It has to do with the amount of sulfuric acid we have in the chamber. So what we do is that we take this experimental run, and then we add them on top of each other, so we get sort of a periodic pattern here. So you have this. This is when you have gamma rays on, and then you have this when you have gamma rays off. And here you have one profile, and here you have another profile. And this is just for one setting of parameters. We then changed parameters, and I mean, just running the experiment, it took more than a year. But what we got was something that actually fitted the theory extremely beautiful. What you see down here is the sulfuric acid that we have in the chamber. I should say that sulfuric acid is something that is produced completely naturally over the oceans, and it comes from mainly from algae and sulfur dioxide. But what we see is that we have a very beautiful agreement between the experiments and then this theoretical line. And when we have a lower ionization in the chamber, we also see a fairly nice agreement. So what it's showing is that aerosols are helping the growth of these small particles. So by adding ionization, we can actually accelerate the growth. Let me try to explain you how it works. So if you have an aerosol particle that is supposed to grow, then mostly it will grow from sulfuric acid, and typically over the oceans you will have about a million particles or sulfur molecules per cubic centimeter, and the number of ions is only about 1,000. So the ions are also sticking to the aerosols, as is this sulfuric acid, and each time it adds a little mass to the aerosol. And naively you would think that it has to do with the concentrations that will say how much the growth rate or how important the ions are compared to the neutral growth. And you will say it's just about 0.0% of that order. But it turns out you have to take into account that we are dealing with charges. And when you are dealing with charges, you get these enhanced interactions. And it turns out that the effective, because of these interactions, it goes up almost two orders of magnitude. And it means that in the atmosphere, you would expect that almost 10% of the growth is due to ions. So that means that if you change the ions, you also change change the growth rate, and that makes it much more likely that they survive to cloud condensation nuclei. So the idea is that you produce new aerosols with cosmic rays. They help the growth, and then they finally become cloud condensation nuclei, and we have some theory, which I will not go into. And then in the end, they can affect clouds. So that's what the experiment seems to be indicating. Now, all of this is about experiments, and you can imagine that maybe the conditions that we have in the experiment is not really what we have over the oceans and so on. So it turns out it's very fortunate that the sun makes what we call natural experiments with the whole Earth that we can use to test this mechanism. What you see here is this is the sun and this is the Earth, and this is what we call coronal mass ejections, where you a lot of plasma is being ejected from the sun. And when you inject this plasma, it's like an umbrella against cosmic rays. So you will typically, if you have a strong event, you can see that you have a large drop in cosmic rays. And then within a week, it goes more or less back as this plasma moves out in interplanetary space. But this is like a natural experiment with the whole Earth, and this we have used extensively recently. What you see here is some of these observations that we did. The red curve is the drop in cosmic rays. This is 15 days before, this is 20 days after. And here you see aerosols dropping down. So when you have fewer cosmic rays, it looks as if there's an effect in the aerosols. And then we have three different satellite projects, all with different algorithms and so on, but they all show an effect, and typically about 5 to 7 days after the minimum here. And that's simply the time it takes for aerosols to grow to become cloud condensation nuclei. The latest thing that we have done is to answer the question, does it change the Earth's radiation budget? And we have used the satellite, which is called the CIRRUS. It's a CIRRUS instrument. And what you see here is three graphs. Let's start with this one. What we have here in the, I think the purple line here, that is the drop in cosmic rays. So here you have day zero, and you have 15 days before and 20 days after. And what you're looking at is shortwave, and you can see that there's a very clear drop following strong Forbes decreases. That's something we see. So it means that less solar radiation is radiated back up until the to the instrument. So it means that more energy is going into the Earth's system. If you look at the long wave, and especially low clouds, which is this purple line, I think. No, it's the red line. It's not really changing very much, and that's simply because... I'll stop in a second. This is simply because of the temperature of low clouds is more or less the same as the surface. So if you have no clouds, or you have many clouds, it doesn't make a big difference. But the important thing is that up here you see that the net radiation, you get almost between 2 and 3 watts more energy into the Earth system from a 15% change in the cosmic ray flux. Let me just show you two more slides. What you see here is the interesting thing is that we can actually look where and what clouds are affected by these changes. So this is the average state before the Forbes decrease, and this is after for the shortwave. And you can see that there's enormous amount of areas that are affected. It sort of lights up in yellow. And you can also see it here in the net radiative that there are these regions, and these regions are mainly over the oceans. So, and if we look at what type of clouds and where they are, so this curve here is where you have low clouds, and you can see the main regions are simply where you have low clouds. So the low clouds are extremely important for this for these changes. So those are the ones that are changing the radiative budget. So let me give a summary of the observations. We have the whole link, more or less. So
we start with solar activity in the form of coronal mass ejections, then we get a decrease in cosmic rays at Earth, and that we call that day zero. Then we see a decrease in the aerosols 4 to 5 days later. These are relatively large aerosols, otherwise we couldn't observe them. And then we see decrease in clouds 5 to 7 days later, and the energy budget of the Earth changes 5 to 7 days later with about 2 to 3 watts energy. And it's mainly low clouds that are responsible for affecting the energy budget, and it's mainly clouds over the oceans that has the largest response. Thank you.
Vielen Dank, Henrik. Es kommen Professor Scherwief und Henrik Svensmark beantworten jetzt dann zusammen die Fragen. Wenn Sie Fragen haben, bitte nicht noch ein Co-Referat, wir sind hinten dran. Möglichst dann an die direkte Person wenden. Okay.
What I would like to refer to is the drawing of the Earth energy budget shown from Professor Scherwief. You wrote the CO2 in the height of the clouds, while Professor Happer said that the CO2 is homogeneously distributed in the whole atmosphere and stratosphere. That's why I wanted to ask you, because I see this in many pictures. And a second point, the NASA has a similar Earth energy budget drawing, a little bit more complex, and they always have two circles. It's written atmosphere, and then you have an arrow of radiation down to space, up to space. And then you have a second circle in which it's written greenhouse gases, and they do the back radiation, the heating down to Earth. And I think that both are the same gases, the CO2 and water and ozone. If you see this like me, did you ever speak with NASA about this, why they have two different circles and not just one circle with all the gases in and one arrow up and another arrow down like you had in your drawing?
I think these kind of sketches are trying to simplify what's going on, but the full picture is what Will Happer has gave us in his talk. It's complicated. You have to solve the whole radiative transfer equation in order to see what's going on. So the kind of cartoons that you see, I described, or what others describe, is just that. It's cartoons trying to simplify things. But the reality is more complicated. You have to do the full radiative transfer calculation in order to see what's going on. You cannot separate, as you say, you cannot separate the greenhouse gases which are emitting back to space from the greenhouses which are emitting to the surface, the back reaction and so forth. It's the same process.
Ja, ich bin kein Physiker und deswegen möchte ich noch etwas genauer verstehen, was die Sonnenaktivität eigentlich ist. Konkrete Frage, die Sonnenflecken korrelieren mit der Sonnenaktivität? In welcher Form oder korrelieren sie überhaupt nicht?
Okay, I didn't hear anything.
Okay, the question was what is basically solar activity? Solar activity is a change in, is basically activity or the activity of the solar magnetic field. It arises from the fact that the outer 40% in radius of the sun is convective. The outer 40% is convective. And because the sun is not rotating as a rigid body, the outer 40% are rotating such that the equator is rotating with an angular speed which is faster than the poles. What happens is that it takes the magnetic field and it changes it from poloidal to toroidal, and it stretches it, and it does a lot of interesting things. And the net result is that every roughly 11 years, the magnetic polarity of the sun switches. It's related to the sunspots, because when the sun for example, is more active and you get more of those fields, the regions that have a magnetic field are lighter than the surrounding because the magnetic field has pressure, but it doesn't have any weight. So those regions are buoyant and they move up and they pierce through the surface and you get these sunspots and these magnetic loops which produce the coronal mass ejections. So this process, which involves the magnetic field, the convection, the rotation, is very complicated, but it manifests itself as the number of sunspots that you have at the surface, the strength of the solar wind, because the convection excites alpha waves, which break in the corona of the sun and hit the corona and produce the solar wind. The amount of UV and the amount of X-rays and such. So all those things change relatively together with this 11-year solar cycle. But overlaid on this 11-year solar cycle, you have long-term secular variations. Such sometimes it's more active and sometimes it's less active. It manifests in all those things, but they don't change exactly together. So sometimes you could see that you know the sunspot number has decreased from one cycle to the other, while the cosmic ray flux has increased.
Okay. Yeah. Excuse me. I don't have a very silly question. I'm a complete layperson. At the one hand, water vapor is an amplifying effect according to the standard theory of CO2. Water vapor is not the same as clouds. In your approach, clouds have a cooling effect, but you need of course to have humidity in the atmosphere in order to generate clouds. So what is what you're reporting kind of a net effect of water vapor and cloud formation, and what is the relationship between the two? Is it cooling or is it warming?
Water vapor tends to heat because it's a greenhouse gas, but water vapor, when it forms clouds, it can heat and it can cool. High cirrus clouds, for example, they tend to heat because they serve as a blanket absorbing infrared radiation that wants to escape to space, but they are relatively transparent such that they allow shortwave radiation to penetrate. Low-altitude clouds, those which appear to be mostly sensitive to the cosmic rays, they tend to cool because they are relatively warm. So if you have them or if you don't have them, you emit roughly the same amount back to space. If you have them, they are white and they reflect a lot of the sunlight. So clouds can be warm, can warm the planet and they can cool the planet. Different models give you different values of what this feedback is. But the feedback, so you change the amount of water vapor, this is some feedback, and then when the water vapor turns into clouds, it produces another feedback, but this feedback is relatively uncertain. So the idea is how can you look at the system as a whole and try to understand what is the total feedback of the system, and this you can do, for example, by looking at historic variations in the energy budget, or you can try to see what is the response that the system has, for example, just under clear skies, in which case you exclude the effects of clouds, or in all of the sky, which is where you look at the combined effect of the clouds and the water vapor that formed them.